Hey folks, I'm back, and it's good to be talking about Phaser again. We had a little bit of a hiatus from game development for a while there, working on some other projects, but we're back talking about something really cool, artificial intelligence. And we are going to be looking at a state-based artificial intelligence in our little space deathmatch game that we're working on here. Today, we are going to be focusing specifically on two states. It's just going to be a state patrol state and a alarm state. So what that means is each enemy on the screen is going to have a very simple set of instructions. Really, that's all artificial intelligence is just a set of instructions that tells a character in your game to follow these rules based on specific environmental considerations. So if you have an enemy who's patrolling, they're just going a certain number of paces in each direction, waiting for something to happen. And the alarm state is when the enemy is aware of you in the environment and is then going to react appropriately. Our version of reacting appropriately in this game is going to be just that the enemy is going to stop patrolling, but ideally in the game itself, the enemy would then start attacking or chasing after you or alerting other enemies that you're in the vicinity. So let's take a look at how that's going to work. First, I just want to show you a couple of changes that we made in the game since the last video. First of all, we have taken all of that logic that we had for moving the player around the screen, and we've moved that out to a separate function. And this is a couple of ways that we could have done this. One way would have been using prototypes. We could have created an abstract class or, you know, an abstract function that would have been a very generic type of unit in our game. And then both of those player and enemy functions could have inherited from that function prototype. But I decided to just move this into, it's not a global function, but it's a function that's global to our play state, which is called move, and which will be used for both players and enemies move them around the screen. Just makes for a little bit cleaner code and follows our don't repeat yourself principles of programming. So let's step through what we've done here. The first thing that I've done is we've added some new functions into our enemy. First we've added a state member variable, which we're going to initially set to patrol. And this is that state that we referred to earlier, which is going to determine which actions our enemy should be taking at any given time. I have also fleshed out some of the other functions that we had in here. We've got our go to XY function, which sets the X destination and Y destination of our enemy to X and Y. We've added in a stop function, which sets our X destination to the current X coordinate and Y destination to the current Y coordinate. And we've added in a patrol function. This patrol function is what is going to check to see if the, like I said, the unit's going to be patrolling 100 paces in either direction. So it's going to check to see if he's reached his destination. If so, it's going to change his direction to the opposite direction by multiplying it by -1, and then calling the goToX function to start moving that character in the other direction. And that is it for the preliminary set of functions that we added in. The update function was added in so that we can handle the enemy within the update state. So let's jump back up to the main update function within our program here. And just the same as we had the player call an update function within the for each statement for our aliens, we are now calling an enemy update function as well. And this update function is what's going to check to see which state the enemy is currently in, and then perform the appropriate actions on that enemy for its given state. So what does that update function actually do? Well, it's checking to see what state the enemy is currently in. And then if it's patrolling, it's setting the speed of that unit to 40. And then it's calling the self.patrol function. And we took a look at that self.patrol function earlier, which is just setting, you know, moving the character in X number of paces in either direction. But here we have alarm. So if the state of the current enemy is alarm, then it's going to set the speed to 0, and it's going to call that self.stop function, which we took a look at earlier. So when do we actually change the state of the enemy? Well, in the game, what we're going to be doing is we're going to be waiting for certain environmental conditions, like I said. So in this case, we're going to be waiting for the player and the enemy to collide. So if you remember in the last example that we looked at, we actually set up collision detection, and that collision detection was used to stop our player if he ran into an enemy. So we are calling that collide function, and you'll notice that in the callback function, we are now passing two parameters, P and E. P and E represent the player and the current enemy that he's colliding with, and we're stopping the player from moving in whatever direction he's moving, and now we are also setting the enemy state to alarm. Now, like I said, really all the alarm state does is stops the enemy, so we could just as easily call e.stop and stop the enemy from moving. But what we're trying to demonstrate here is that we can actually change his state to alarm, and we can build on that. We can, you know, have him start attacking or have him start chasing you until, you know, something triggers him to change his state yet again. Let's say you move a far enough distance away from him that he can no longer see you, in which case he goes back to patrol state. So this gives us the ability to kind of control what's happening with our enemy throughout the course of the game. And it allows us to control them individually so that even though his state is alarmed, the other character on the screen may still be patrolling. So we can actually take a look at that here. Well, here we just have one enemy moving around. And if we collide into him, you'll see that he changes his state to alarm and he stops moving. If we decided to add in some additional enemies, and let's just put one 400 and 100, the other alternate side of the screen. Now, if we collide into this guy, nothing happens with this one. He's just continuing to patrol as if nothing had ever happened, and this one has changed his state to alarm. Now, that's not saying that we couldn't do something with this one. He could trigger an alarm that would alert all enemies on screen that you were there, and they could all come racing towards you. So, obviously, the limitations are, you know, to the extent that you can imagine them. So, this is really a pretty basic rundown of how you build artificial intelligence into your game. It is not too hard to get some basic behaviors programmed in for your characters on the game. Obviously, you can continue to build on this and make something extremely complex. And, you know, you can look at different libraries that can be used for pathfinding and other types of intelligence that can further improve the artificial intelligence of the characters on the screen. So I encourage you to take a look at some of those things, and appreciate you checking out this video. Comments, please, down in the comments section, get me on Twitter at @ignoreintuition. Always happy to hear your feedback, and look forward to the next screencast. Thanks much.